Hello, how are you? Today I want to share with you about Arreola's class, which is a book that I have written about my memories, what I remember about the teachings of one of my best professors, whose name is Juan José Arreola. So I want to dedicate this presentation to Mari Cris from Lapu Lapu, Filipinas, my girl. So I do this for her, and I hope you like it. So I'm gonna reduce my screen. I put it in the right side. And I'm gonna bring the set of slides. So this is called Arreola's Class, or The Mind of the Writer. Juan José Arreola was a Mexican. Juan José Arreola was a Mexican writer, a teacher of literature and of writing, who died in 2001. The five main books of Arreola were the ones mentioned above, and you can see their illustrations below. Varia Invención, which can be translated as Several Invention. Then Bestiario, that can be translated as Bestiary. And before that, he wrote Confabulario, which can be translated Confabulations, Confabulary. And then he wrote his only novel, which is called La Feria, The Fair in English. And the last literary work is Palindroma, Palindrome. He also wrote an inventory, which was based on the articles, editorial writings for a newspaper. And he also had his prefaces and prologues and writings of different magazines compiled by his son, also Arreola, in this book that we can see in the right side, which is a compilation of his works, and it's called Prosa Dispersa, Diverse Prose. Two palindromes taken from his books are shown above, are the next ones. Eres o no eres, seré o no seré. And as you can see, they make sense in Spanish because they can be read from left to right, or also from right to left. So that's the characteristic of a palindrome, that you can read it from left to right or from right to left. It's saying you are or you are not, I will be or I won't be. But in Spanish you can read the same sentence from left to right than from right to left, not so in English. And that's in his book Palindrome. The other palindrome is Sara Mas Amarás, that also in Spanish, as you can see, can be read from left to right than from right to left. Is Sara, you will love more. And this can be read in both ways, only in Spanish. In the lower left, I am doing my reading of The Fair in the library that is called by his name, Juan José Arreola, in Zapotlán el Grande, which is the town where he was born. Then in the center is a cartoon of Juan José Arreola, and in the right side I am in the outside of the big library, also called Juan José Arreola in Guadalajara City. And I used to do interviews of him for my homeworks in high school, And a part of this, Arreola gave me classes outside of the classroom. During my childhood and adolescence, maybe since I was 9 years old, 9 to 10, and so on until I completed my high school in the 80s. And the teachings that he gave me determined my existence. That in the picture is an interview that I did to him for an essay that I needed to do in a collective group for the high school about his thoughts on the youth. What is he thinking about the youth? And that was an interesting experience with the little cassette recorders of those days. And recently, I was in Mexico. Well, I am back in Mexico now, but at that time, last year, I was in Mexico and decided to write my memories, my remembrances of those classes that Arreola gave me. His sister Virginia wrote for me the preface, and his sister is the one that is with me in this picture. She is now 84 years old, and behind her you can see the part of the painting of the photograph of her father. And here I am in the house where Arreola used to live, which also was his house, looking at the town of Zapotlán from his balcony, from his sear on his house. Now this house belongs to the culture department of Mexico. It's as a museum, it's like a museum, but it keeps most of the books that he used to read, and it keeps most of his paintings that he got, that he bought, and photographs of him, pictures of him of different times of his life, and also some sculptures and his own typewriters, and also his desk and his round window that he asked to Mr. Tijalino, who also died, a nice sculpture, to make it for him. Next, we will see the 12 steps that Arreola recommended for us to become good readers, good speakers, good writers, professors, and more. The first point that he emphasized for us is that we need to read. He used to say, to be a good writer, you need to be a good reader. And he is doing what he preached in his reading in all these pictures that you can see. His second point is to know the original texts. That is important. To have a better understanding of its content, he told us. So the original texts, for example, for the Bible, are the Greek for the New Testament and the Hebrew for the Old Testament. And some portions of the Old Testament and of the New Testament are also in Aramaic, like the book of Matthew, and like some fragments of the book of Daniel in the Old Testament and of Esther are in Aramaic. So we needed to know that. And he, for example, he liked to go to the originals also in the Italian and in the French tongue for the poets that he most liked, that he most enjoyed, like Paul Claudel from France. His third point is to compare different translations of the same text to be able to understand it better, he said, like different versions of the Bible, and he had several of them, So he used to read to us from the different versions of the Bible, both in Spanish, but also in Italian and in French. And in that way, he reached a more deeper and wider understanding of the biblical text. But he also applied this to compare the best translators of the writers that he liked the most. His fourth point for us that he taught us, that Arreola taught us, is called to discern. And when I was teaching this in the United States, one of the students asked me in the United States, what does it mean, discern? So discern is to reason, to separate that which is good from that which is bad, that which is truthful from that which is false, that which is beautiful from that which is repugnant, but also that which is literary from that which is real, literal. And here we have different fragments that I also translated into English for you. For example, here is the advertisement, and he wrote this: whenever the presence of the woman is difficult, onerous, or damaging, either in the room or of the bachelor, either in the room of the bachelor, there is milk and honey under your tongue, says the Song of Songs. You can emulate the pleasures of Solomon. Make a mixture, said Arreola, in this of his texts, that is like a sci-fi, science fiction satire, which is called Advertisement. And Arreola is quoting from the Song of Solomon, chapter 4, verse 11, the second part, honey and milk. And of course, we are not gonna get into details at this point about that text, but we can see that Arreola used to take biblical texts, even if many times was just for the purpose of illustrating his points in a satirical way. And in these pages of mine, he talks about those days of his youth. And he says, already with the rigor of the age, and almost responsible of my acts, I speak clean and anciently of the evil and the good. What is important and painful to me, is that half of what I wrote until now, fortunately very little, aligns its letters with the hosts of, evil. That's in the preface by Arreola of this book that he compiled of other of his texts, that is called These Pages of Mine. And we complete here the Song 4:11 of Solomon, honey and milk are under thy tongue. And this was the note by Carmen de Mora, a lady that did a special edition also of the works of Arreola. So in this text of sci-fi satire called Advertisement, Arreola is way time ahead of the development of that novel that became in two occasions a movie in United States of the Stepford Wives. So he used the satire to present some points that at the end make you to think, like for the woman to be loving to their men so that they may enjoy their companies as they are, instead of wanting to replace them. In the fiction of Arreola is like with a robotic woman. But I put that aside, And I read right now his fifth point, which is to vocalize, reading out loud the words, putting into them all the spirit that we have inside. This is what Arreola used to tell us. Put all your emotion, all your being into your reading. This is what Arreola used to teach to us as the vocalize. Now, his sixth point is to select. Keep in your life and in your memory only those things that are useful to you. This is what Arreola used to tell us. And in the bottom right picture that we have here, Arreola is talking with one of the presidents of Mexico that before was a radio speaker, radio host, and became a president of Mexico. So he used to hang around with big personalities. So he was also selective as per the relations that he had, the friends that he made. So his seventh point is to remember. Make use of your memory, frequently remembering the readings that you enjoy the most. And for example, here we have one of the artists that Arreola liked very much from France, Joubert, in the bottom left of me. Then it is next is one of the best poets from Mexico that Arreola liked to read a lot. He even took some of the poems of Carlos Pellicer, the one that is portrayed there, and transformed those poems into his daily prayers. It's interesting. And then the third one is the poet that I mentioned before that Arreola liked very, very much from France, Paul Claudel. Paul Claudel had a very intelligent poetry, but many times was complex. And Arreola said, Claudel first needs to be translated into French, so I may understand his writing, because so complex that it was, even if he was writing already in French, but in a complex French. So his eighth point that Arreola gave us is to imitate. That's one of his favorite teachings. He said, imitate the themes and the styles of others, adapting them to what we really want to say. So he used to say, copy the words, for example, of Cervantes in a place of La Mancha, of whose name I don't want to remember, and change it to adapt it to your circumstance. In a specific place of downtown of Guadalajara, I don't want to say the place, but the incident was this, and then he developed the story. So he said, use common clichés that are famous and change them to adapt those statements to your own writing, to your own circumstance. So imitate the themes, the styles of others, adapting them to what you really want to say. And I understand why he said that, because he was also an actor. So he was imitating. He was always that I saw him in a position of an actor, like acting. He used a long cape, 18th, 19th century long capes, black cape. When I was younger, I thought it was like a superhero cape. He used to drive a little motorcycle, a Vespa, through the town with a hat. And when I saw him, I say, hey, may I speak to you? And he told me, yes, come to my house. And then from his balcony, his open balcony, looking at the town from the top in the Mount of the Tecolote was the name. From that place, he used to teach to us all of these things. Sometimes I was alone. Sometimes I was with a cousin or with a friend. But he was always teaching. Everyone that wanted to hear what he had to say, he presented the best information that he wanted to present at that point. And below you can see different roles of Arreola, as a clown in the left side, as a chevalier at the center, and in the right side, like as a bishop, as like a British bishop. And his point number 9 is to inspire. Think in something sublime, or listen to music, to speak, to write, or to manifest it with your actions. That's what he said. You are inspired, and then you can write about it. You can do good things, and then explain in writing what you did. He also liked to do drawings, some paintings, and some other people also do paintings for him. Like the second painting, somebody did a painting for him, for one of his texts about a shoe fixer, shoemaker, that did a bad fix of his shoes, that didn't go into his feet as he wanted. So he's writing him a very funny letter about that circumstance, about that problem. And then the drawing in the left side is a master for the cover of his magazines, that he was a very good editor of literary works of himself and of others. So he had, through his life, different magazines, editions that he used to do with the best of the writers. The best of the best of that time went through his pages, including the same Carlos Pellicer, the poet that I mentioned before that he edited, but also young writers of that time, and he used to do the corrections of their writings, like Carlos Fuentes was one of them. He also helped a lot to what to read to Juan Rulfo and to many others. Carlos, I mentioned already Carlos Pellicer, but also Emilio Pacheco and many others that, as I remember them, I will mention them. But he even helped to improve the literary style of Jorge Luis Borges from Argentina. Mm-hmm. And Arreola really liked the horses, so the third one is one of his drawings. And then somebody else did a horse, the fourth one, also for another of their works, their writings and their magazines that he used to do with his students. So he used to put the cover of horses in his magazines because he liked them. So his point number 10 is to live your life intensely, he used to tell us, so you can have something to say, so you can have something to write about, something to teach. This is a beautiful point, to live. And here Arreola is pointing to heaven, to one of his best teachers, Velasco Cisneros. And then at the center is one of the sculptures in the plaza, in the garden, in the park of Zapotlan, where he was born. And in the right side, I am by the side of one of the pillars of the illustrious men of Zapotlan. All those pillars, they removed them from that park to increase the size of the green grass. Maybe in the future they are going to put again some illustrious men memorials, I don't know. Then the point that Arreola put as the number 11 for us, for me, is to write. He used to say, you need to write your thoughts, your diaries, your poems, your past experiences. Write everything, he used to tell to us. In that way, you will have in the future, in your future, things to think about, and maybe even things to improve, to produce a poem or a book or a novel. And his last point, his point number 12, is to teach. He used to tell to us, teach all that you know, all that you have lived, all that you have written, and how you succeed in your lives, how you are coming around, coming about, how are you living your life. And here, as I said, he's talking with Jorge Luis Borges in one of the times that he went to Argentina with Jorge Luis Borges, and Arreola told him how to improve his writing to make it more original for him. So, to illustrate the 12 points previously mentioned, we will see some examples of what Arreola used to read and to write as well. So, both of his writing and his reading. His reading first, yeah, and then his writing. So, for the first point, to read, we have that he liked to read Dostoevsky, and later on in life, he read also Schiller. He liked some poem by Hugo, but not so much of the writings of Hugo. And he always emphasized when they used the Bible. So, for example, one of the editorials, Bruguera, put as the heading of one of the novels of Dostoevsky, a scripture from the Bible, Luke 8, 27-39, which is the story of the pigs, when Jesus Christ heals a man that was possessed and casts out all his 2,000 demons to the pigs, and then the pigs, possessed by those demons, precipitate into the water of a lake, and they drown, and the demons get trapped under the water and taken to the prison of waters that are down on the depths of the earth, on the deeps of the earth, in the surroundings of the Euphrates River, as we have learned. So, of the Eternal in Man is one of the books that he really liked from Max Scheler. And here I have some of the texts of Arreola. This is a text called The Convert, inspired in a real person. But I like what Arreola says in here, and let me show you what he is saying. Potent. In loneliness, I had time to walk and retrace numerous ways. I reconstructed piece by piece imaginary buildings. I got lost in my own labyrinth, and I only found the exit when the voice of God came to seek me. Millions of ideas fled away, and I felt that my head was the hollow of an ocean that suddenly was being left empty. That's a fragment of the writing style of Arreola. And of course, the translation of all of these fragments is mine, so it can always be improved. So Arreola did read to us the translation into Spanish of the Song of Songs by Fray Luis de León. Fray Luis de León was one of the greatest users of the language in Spanish of the century of gold of the writing in Spain, or the century of gold of the Spanish writing. And he did the translation of the Song of Songs in a time where it was forbidden to translate into their native tongues the books of the Bible. The rule, the Catholic rule, was that only in Latin you could hear or read the Bible, which is ridiculous. But Fray Luis de León said, I want to have in Spanish this Song of Songs to give it to my female cousin, So he did it, and that got him into prison. So he stayed in prison for 11 years, and once he was released, he said to his students in his class, as we were teaching yesterday, and he resumed and continued his class from 11 years before. So that's a very interesting example of somebody that put aside all the negatives and he just retraced the positive path that he was leading with his students. And it says here about his translations, I rose, I, comma, rose of the field, the plant, the flower, the rose. I rose of the field. Let me close the door because it's making some noise. Excuse me. So we need to learn how to read, because if I didn't put the comma, I rose is what I did right now, rose up. In the past I meant to wake up, but I, comma, rose, the flower of the field. The Hebrew word is habatzelet, that according to the most learned in that tongue, in the tongue of the Hebrew, is not any rose, but one certain species of them, in the black color, but very beautiful, and of a gentle odor, she being beautiful and dark. Lily of the valleys, that for being in a more humid place, is cooler and better looking. This is the wife, this, the wife, let's correct again the reading. This the wife says of the husband, according to the learning of Fray Luis de León, as if she were saying more clearly, I am the black rose of the field, is the context for the meaning of Habatzelet, the black rose, very rare, very unique in the Middle East. And you, husband of mine, you are the lily of the valleys, which shows what good it speaks of the beauty of the one with the attractiveness of the other, and that, as it is said of the betrothed, are for to be one. The rose and the lily are for to be one, such as the rose and the lily, and the word lily is in Hebrew, Sosanach, the, maybe from where we got the name Susanna, Susanna, lily, in the Hebrew, that together grows the gentleness of both and are pleasant to the sight and to the other more than each one on its own. So this is very interesting. He says the male is in a whiter color than the woman in this Song of Songs. And it's something corroborated when I did my study on the Hebrew of the Song of Songs. I saw that he is whiter. His skin is whiter, in the same way his hair is of the golden color. And she is more brown and darker. But they two together, they fuse and they transform into one, producing a delicious smell, is what we learn. So this is beautiful. And this is the kind of things that Arreola used to read to us. So we really got so excited about reading, especially about reading biblically oriented material, because he told us the best material you read, the best way you can speak and write. Then he told us that the Song of Songs was also the source of literary inspiration of one of the great of the golden century of Spain writers. And this is Francisco de Quevedo, and his sculpture is in the left side. The other one also was a sculpture in Spain of Fray Luis de León in the previous slide. And Francisco de Quevedo inspired all his writing in his early learning from the Bible, especially from the Song of Songs. And he did the paraphrases as Arreola used to teach to us as well, taking themes, topics, and styles from the Song of Songs from the Bible and adapting them to his writing, to what he wanted to say, the way he wanted to say it. The wise says that he'll kiss me with the kiss of his mouth, because of sweet honeycombs is filled. The more the gall and more sugar touches, his lips are the glory of my pain. And in such an immense multitude of grievances, his kisses are the life of my lips. If your own hand won't lead me to you, without you I will not hit so great a road. Be husband and guide by the mount and the plain, and we will run after your divine odor. Lead me to you by your way held by you, being husband and truth, way and life. If your own hand don't lead me to you, without you I will not hit so great road. Be husband and guide through the mount and the plain, and we will run after your divine odor. Lead me as I am held to you by your own way, be in you husband and truth and way and life. Do not make fuss of my dark color, that the sun is guilty in these plains. So you see, I may have repeated something without realizing from here, from the if to life. So I repeated it twice. It's only once in the original text. Sorry about that. The Song of Songs was also the source of inspiration for one of the great Mexican poets, Amado Nervo, and he wrote The Broken Prism. And here we're gonna read part of the Amado Nervo writings inspired in the Song of Songs by the Song of Solomon. First eclogue, the arrival of the beloved at the distance, cutting out all beauty, cutting out all beauty from the white nebulae of the morning. And again, there is a comma after out, cutting out, comma, all beauty from the white nebulae of the morning. You see, if you don't put the space of the comma, it seems that all beauty is cut out. But if you put the comma, you see that it's like the silhouette that is appearing, cutting out the background, so to speak. Cutting out, comma, all beauty from the white nebulae of the morning. The beloved descends through the winding path. The boyfriend looks at her at the borders of the inheritance filled with flowers and humid. The sun arises, crowning the snowy school of a mountain like a votive fire over an immense altar of sacrifices. It smells like roses. So Amado Nervo likes to put first the surroundings, the environment, the ecological background of his story, and it's very interesting because the mountain with snow, very cold, is like the mountain that we have here in winter in Zapotlan, very close, is the cold mountain of Colima, and it has snow in winter. Then, in the case of the Nicaraguan poet Rubén Darío, he not only mentioned the Song of Songs in his writings, but he also mentioned the Book of Ruth and the Ecclesiastes. In his autumn poem, it says, "Give back for roses the orange blossoms, that it is playing the song of that Song of Songs of Solomon. Even in the twilight hour, a voice is singing. Ruth, with a smile, is coming to glean for Boaz. You have enjoyed the friendly hour, and afterwards hear the imprecation of the formidable Ecclesiastes. So you see, he writes about the three most important celebrations of the use of the Hebrews, which are the Ecclesiastes. Then in the day of the tabernacles, it was celebrated by reading about the Ecclesiastes. The readings and the feast lasted 7 days, so they used to read Ecclesiastes, and they do this in the week of the Feast of Tabernacles, that was between September and October. It started, I think, the 15th of the month of Tisri, and the 10th of that month was the Feast of Atonement. And then the other celebration was Pentecost, that was celebrated 50 days after the very beginning of the offering of the barley. So the barley was offered, and 50 days later they offered the wheat, and this was Pentecost, which meant 50 days later, 50 later, 50 Pentecost. So it lasted only 1 day. It was always after a Sabbath. So it was always what we call Sunday, the day of Pentecost. It was the same day where God decided for his son to send Holy Spirit, in the day of Pentecost, 50 days after the resurrection of the Christ, which means 10 days after the ascension of the Christ. So here, during that day, that was a Sunday, from evening to evening, for us will be like the evening of a Saturday to the evening of a Sunday, because the days of the Hebrews go from evening to evening, and that whole day they used to read the book of Ruth, the day of Pentecost. And the other book that they used to read during the 7 days of the Passover is the book of the Song of Songs. So there we have, mentioned by Dario, the three books, and he mentioned them backwards. He mentions first Ecclesiastes, then Ruth, then Song of Songs. I put them in the proper order, but he mentions them backwards, as in his poem, the man that is writing wanting to go backwards in his age, in his life, back in time. That's the meaning of the poem of Autumn. And here we have that poem written by his own hand in a sculpture that is of the poet Rubén Darío in Nicaragua. And as we read here, Darío mentions the three books of the Bible. And then we have Gabriela Mistral, another great poet. She is from Chile, and she is a Nobel Prize also, who wrote a poem inspired by the book of Ruth, in the same way as Victor Hugo did. And I really like more the version written by Gabriela Mistral, whose original name was Lucila Godoy. And I will give you my translation into English of some of his verses written originally in Spanish. Ruth Moabite, to glean is going to the fields, even if she does not have a mean field. A mean field should be F-I-E-L-D. She thinks that God is owner of the prairies, and that she spikes on a divine estate. And that she spikes is grabbing from the floor, from the ground, from the earth, the things that are left after the harvest on the ground. Boaz, the owner of that field, F-I-E-L-D, sorry, is field. Boaz has sat in the plentiful harvest. The wheat terrain is an infinite wave from the mountains to where he is resting. And let's read the fragment that I like the most. And in the wave of gold, Ruth the Moabite comes, gleaning, to find her destiny. Oh, that is beautiful. She went just to harvest wheat to have something to eat for her and for her mother-in-law. And there, while she was harvesting, the fragments left after the real harvest, she found her husband in Boaz, the owner of the field. So we have here a sculpture in Chile, in one of the schools of the poet Gabriela Mistral, who had a school in Mexico and became very important in Mexico. Vasconcelos took her to Mexico to lead and to teach, and she wrote a beautiful book with the selections of the best readings of her childhood, her youth. And this is in a place called Coquimbo in Chile. And her handwriting is in the right side, in my right side, her handwriting. So this is a better version for me than what Victor Hugo tried to do with the Book of Ruth, which Victor Hugo entitled Boaz, Boaz Asleep. Now let's go to the second step, originals. Let's read the originals. In the topic of the originals, Arreola did mention the biblical ancient texts of the Hebrew and of the Greek, like the Leningradensis, the Vaticanus, for the Greek, the Vaticanus. Mm-hmm. And here we see some fragments of both of those texts, the Leningradensis in Hebrew, that you read from right to left, and the Vaticanus in Greek, that you have in the right side. But Arreola, he also translated literary texts from the French and Italian, such as A Family of Trees by Jules Renard, and those kind of writers and writings inspired him. And as a matter of fact, Gabriela Mistral is the one that chose in Spanish A Family of Trees, and Arreola just improved the understanding of it by comparing it with the original text and looking to which words in Spanish sounded better than the way Gabriela Mistral had it. So this is an improvement by Arreola of a previous translation by somebody else. Let's read this as I have translated it, and I improve it as I am reading it live. A Family of Trees by Jules Renard, Spanish, Juan José Arreola, English, Fernando Castro Chávez. It's me, the one that did the translation into English for you, for your enjoyment. And especially, as I say, to Marie-Chris Villaveto, love you, I love you. I find them after crossing a plain burned by the sun. It's a beautiful, it's a poetical writing in prose. By reason of the noise, they depart from the road. They dwell the uncultivated fields near a fountain only known by the birds. Beautiful, beautiful, poetical prose. From the distance, they seem impenetrable. When I get closer, their trunks separate. They receive me with patience. They can rest. They can rest while refreshing me. But I can guess that they look distrusting at me. So you see, he talks about trees, Jules Renard, but in a very, very anthropomorphic way, in a human-like way. And then I'm gonna read a fragment that is present in his bestiary, the same book that put his translations from other writers, and those translations, he called them approximations. Now the text that he wrote, I took a fragment, and it's the giraffe. And the painting that you see of the face of the giraffe was actually done by his original book of bestiary by a painter that used the tip of silver to do that painting. The giraffe. The giraffe could represent better than anybody the daydream of the spirit, seeking on high that which others find at the ground level. So that's the very interesting style of Arreola of writing. Now we're gonna see the third point to compare that Arreola used to teach to us. And in relation with comparing, he did compare different versions of a text, even in one same language, like the different versions of the Bible in Spanish, and he had several of them. But he then explained that the Complutian, that was a very special scholar work done by Cisneros, the one that became the confessor of the Queen Isabella, the Complutian version intrigued him, and he showed some of the scriptures for us describing the painful process to translate the Complutian, to have it in the original Hebrew, and the way they made the metal symbols for each one of the letters of Hebrew, and then to have it also in Greek, and then to have it in Latin. It was at that time not possible yet to have it in Spanish, because as I mentioned, when I mentioned Fray Luis de León, it was already a forbidden thing to do, to translate the Latin of the Bible into Spanish, which is ridiculous. Thank God that now we can read the Bible in any of the languages, almost, I think, of the languages of this world. So the conclusion was the first great effort in the Spanish language to bind in one same book the Hebrew, the Aramaic as well, and the Greek of the Bible. And if I remember correctly, they used to call the Aramaic in that version the Chaldean, which is actually the mixture of the Hebrew with the Babylonian. But they added also the version of the Bible in Aramaic. Arreola mentioned the importance of the Masora, which are the notes by the Hebrew scribes done to the Bible to preserve the integrity of the biblical scriptures, in this case of the Bible of the Old Testament. They used to count word by word and put in the margins, wherever they could fit, the number of words per page and what kind of words and the sense of those words and the paragraphs. They tried to keep as defense to safeguard the Hebrew text from adulterations. So the Masora apparently was an scholarly work started with Ezra in the Old Testament, and now in the 19th and 20th century, some Hebrews recovered that material and put it together. One of them that did an enormous work to recover the notes from each page of the Hebrew versions is called Ginsburg, and you have his photograph here, and some of the texts that he used from where he took the Masora. And somebody even earlier than him, Jacob Ben Chaim, also did a work, and of course Bullinger did also an amazing work on retrieving the research materials for the more precise understanding of the Bible. This is Ethelbert Dovia Bullinger from England in the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century. So it says here, later the Masora integrated by Ginsburg was made known in the Companion Bible by Ethelbert W. Bullinger, a great British book of biblical research, the Companion Bible. And he was a great biblical student. And these are some of his amazing books that I deeply recommend you to find on the internet, the works of Ethelbert W. Bullinger, as I wrote here up. He made a critical lexicon and concordance in the English and Greek New Testament. He did an amazing work of figures of speech used in the Bible. He also did an amazing job on the witness of the stars to identify the original names of the stars and the constellations and how they were prophesying the coming of our Lord, the coming of our Jesus. And then he had more other books, like the one that is seen partially in yellow, Numbers in Scripture. It's another amazing book that describes the biblical meaning of the numbers. So the next step, the next point is to discern. And here, he mentioned Arreola that he liked especially the first complete Bible in Spanish, the Christian Bible of the Bearer, translated by Casiodoro de Reina in 1569. And that was the name of this version because in the cover had a big bear trying to reach a honeycomb, trying to take it. So this is like, your word, O God, is sweeter than honeycomb, and I will grab it and I will reach to it. So that's the sense. And these are some pages of that first version ever of the whole Bible in Spanish. And he did also drawings of the book, for example, of the prophet Ezekiel. And he shows here the prophet Ezekiel receiving from God the information, the book that he needed to read and to transmit, and how he saw the glory of God. In the right side, a fragment of that drawing by Cassiodoro. The Bible, which is the sacred books of the Old and New Testament, this is how it appears in Spanish. The Word of our God, look at this, how beautiful. The Word of our God remains forever. We come and go, we stay today and tomorrow not. We may live 90 years or a little more, but we are still passing by. But the Word of God remains forever. The wisdom of God, the revelation that is coming from heaven, all of that, because He's alive, remains forever. And that Cassiodoro put it from the Hebrew. You can see the Hebrew that you read from right to left. And what it says, he put it in Spanish, I am putting it in English, in his version of 1569. The Word of our God remains forever. Oh, that's beautiful. And then here, I put drawing of Ezekiel receiving a scroll from God and God's portable throne at the right side. So this is what he put. Now, one of his short stories of Arreola is called Verily I Say Unto You, which is based in the Bible scriptures of the New Testament, and tells about his occurrence to use science to pass a camel through the eye of a needle. And of course he's enjoying while doing it this, because he even knows that the real understanding of the eye of the needle is a lower arch on the walls for the entering to a city. The doors that enter through the wall to a walled city is called the needle, the eye of a needle, from where the camel go in and needed to bend to cross. But he uses again as a satire the understanding that most people in ignorance of the original Greek thinks of passing a camel through the eye of a needle is like the whole camel through it, but that's not the meaning, as I say, but he uses it as a sarcastic way So I'm going to read first what the scripture of the Bible says about it and how he put it in his text, in his history, sarcastic history. Jesus Christ said, "And again I say unto you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God." And then Arreola wrote, "If Harpad Niklaus, that's the scientist that wants to disintegrate a camel and make it pass to our little eyes of our little needles, if Harpad Niklaus is a manufacturer of chimeras and after his death follows a whole line of imposters," it says all of this in science is a lie, "his humanitarian work will only increase in greatness as a geometric progression or as a chicken's tissue culture by Carrel." So Carrel was another scientist that cultures tissues artificially, like chicken skin and chicken organs. So he's using sarcastically saying, "If the thing of passing a real camel by disintegration through the eye of the needle and then reintegrating the camel in the other side of the eye of the needle, if this doesn't work, at least, even if the scientist was an imposter and all his successors and his helpers, at least he's gonna help by the donations of the rich men to reduce the richness of those rich men and to make them more humble." Something like that is the sarcastical way that Arreola used to put that story of the Bible. And then Arreola not only wrote, but he mostly liked to speak, and he was frequently invited to give speeches. So in one speech, which he called The Implantation of the Spirit, he speaks that we are born without spirit and that we accept the spirit consciously when we grow. But he understands of spirit as a natural ability, but we as believers, as Christians, understand spirit as the divine nature that dwells in us when we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord. So for us the spirit is supernatural. Arreola did not understand that so clearly, and he talked only of the human spirit, like meaning the human intelligence, the human inspiration, but that can be a totally natural thing. So Arreola says, this is part of his speech, he says, "The creation of man is not contemporaneous to the appearance over the surface of the earth of beings with the appearance of being human." That's what Arreola said. That's a magnificent idea. The world could have been populated by infinite creatures, and what seemed to be a man was not a man yet, even if it walked on 2 feet. Was not a man yet, even if he walked on 2 feet, and even if it had a claw in the hand. I so love to emphasize the idea of the 6,000 years. Arreola was a believer in the biblical idea that humans, human beings from Adam to us, had an antiquity of only 6,000 years, as the Bible says. And he says, and he explains why. Because starting only from the 6,000 years, we have monuments that speak about humanity, and that point to us the first human settlements, and that finding, those findings that are as older as 6,000 years, show the first human settlements. He says the writing evidence and the architectural good evidence of men over the earth is only as old as 6,000 years. That's what Arreola used to say. So he believed in the 6,000 years for the age of man, as the Bible said. And he said, using different understandings of writers, like Edmond Gossin, that is presented in the right side, that said that whatever looked like human before the 6,000 years was not human, but just animals like big apes that looked like humans but were not human. And also we know by our study of the Bible that all the bones of Neanderthal, Homo erectus, Australopithecus, Pithecanthropus, all of those are animals that look like humans but were not human at all. That's interesting. Even if they had intelligence, they were not human as us. And that's something very interesting that Arreola believed in the 6,000 years for the age of humans over the face of the earth. Furthermore, in his own novel of Arreola, The Fair Convergent, he mentions Isaiah. So his novel is convergent because it's made by fragments of things that are happening at about the same time, simultaneously by different people talking or acting. And in that novel, he mentions Isaiah, and that's a citizen from Zapotlan, from his city of birth, from where I am transmitting this. And this Isaiah is a citizen that was a born again man of the spirit, a born again of the spirit of God, who speaks in tongues. Garakatafatni, Shadni, Hodnishi, Okoti, Fodnishi, Totnushi, Kurikotni, Fodniwi. This is the way of speaking in tongues, and then you give the interpretation. I am your God. I want you to be prosperous, to be happy in this life. So I am giving you everything that you need, and you need to continue also acknowledging me and loving me, for example. So that man in the novel used to speak in tongues, and is Don Isaiah. So let me translate what I put about this in my translation from the fragments. In The Fair, the novel of Arreola, a very clever writing that talk about this person, Isaiah. He had made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand had he hid me, and he made me a polished shaft. In his quiver had he hid me. Will preserve thee and give thee for a covenant of the people, to establish the earth, to cause to inherit the desolate heritages. And this is actually the beginning of his novel. He put this as the heading, the main heading of the whole novel of The Fair. So he took actually a writing of Isaiah, the actual prophet Isaiah, Isaiah 49, 2 and 8, and he decided to put that as the top of his novel, as the beginning of his novel, epigraph. And then we're gonna hear the actual voice of Mr. Isaiah, the human, in The Fair, contemporaneous to the time of the writing of The Fair. And he also mentions scripture with his speaking. Now, Mr. Isaiah, the first one in the heading of the whole novel of The Fair is the actual prophet Isaiah of the Bible. The second one writing here or speaking here in the writings of Arreola is Mr. Isaiah. From whence have they taken the rich their money? You have devoured the harvest, and of the leftovers of the poor your houses are full. And I am not who says this. That's the voice of Isaiah quoting scripture. Hurry, almost running, the way is down the slope. Instead of what the president did, the municipal president, I had taken them up the hill for the aggravation of that band of dissolute folks, that they may throw their intestines climbing up, falling down, rolling on their way back, all drunk of all their iniquities and of all their harlotry. So the municipal president of that time of the writing of The Fair decided to take away all the prostitute women of the town, of the little town, and put them away in one specific place that was down the slope. And Mr. Isaiah said the municipal president should have put those places on the top of the mount to make it harder for the ones wanting to go there, as we read, and what he thought should be better for them. Mr. Isaiah said the novel of La Feria, The Fair, is a Protestant and has the gift of tongues. That's how Arreola called it. is charisma of tongues, is the operation of the grace of God of tongues, and the mouth filled with Bible at all times. So I say I want to be like Mr. Isaiah. But it's interesting that he puts in one of his writings a man who actually speaks in tongues, that is born again of the Spirit. That's very interesting. And then in one text by Arreola that is called The Black Knight, when he is losing at chess, again that Arreola used to practice chess, he liked it very much to play chess, he mentions biblical phrases regarding Job's grief. And we're going to see some of these translations. The original text is in Jeremiah 20:17, but not only there, it's also in Job. Because he, the Akochuo, did not kill me before my birth. It's like the one that helps bringing out the babies when they are being born, so that my mother might have been my grave. This is what Jeremiah was saying when he was feeling sad, as Job also used to say this when he was sad. Why the doctor that was about to bring me out didn't kill me before my birth, so that my mother might have been my grave. He felt really like sad to say that extreme thing. So Arreola, in a sarcastic way, says the same when he loses a chess game. And he writes this in his text, The Black Knight. I realize then that my life hasn't been but a triangulation. I always choose wrong my objects of love, and I lose them one after another, like the queen 7 pawn. Now 3 figures are against me, king, bishop, and knight. I am no longer any sort of vertex. I am a dead point in the final triangle. Why to continue playing? Why did not I let myself to receive the shepherd's mate, or once and for all the fool's mate? Or why did not I fall into a variant of legal? Why God didn't kill me inside the belly of my mother, letting me there, leaving me locked there? So you see the sarcastic voice of Arreola when he loses in the game of chess, that he really liked it very much. So in another of his stories that I translate in English as villager, in Spanish is pueblerina, he mentions a taurine scene in which when the shocked bull falls, he observes that the town was looking at him like in the biblical valley of Jehoshaphat, like all the eyes put into him. And to be a man with horns in Mexico means that his wife is going out with another man or man. And he was a lawyer and his wife was doing that. So he was like a bull and everybody knew. So everybody was looking at him like in a spectacle, like in a taurine scene, a bullfight. Yeah. And Arreola put this. With his eyes blurred, he saw opening around him a gigantic tide, something like a Jehoshaphat valley, filled with fellas with lighted suits. The congestion then plunged into his spine, like a thrust to the cross. And Don Fulgencio, that's the name of this man that was being cheated by his wife, Don Fulgencio, the lawyer, rolled upside down without a lace. That's the figure that everybody knew about what was going on with his wife. And then Carmen de Mora, the editor of the Confabulary, mentions this about the Valley of Jehoshaphat, the Jehoshaphat Valley, name commonly given to the Kidron Valley between Jerusalem and the Mount of Olives. A text of the Bible has given origin to the tradition that the universal judgment will take place in this valley. I will also gather all nations and will bring them down into the valley of Jehoshaphat. That's what the Bible says and continues, and will plead with them there for my people and for my heritage, Israel. This is in Joel 3:2. This kind of biblical references is very frequent in Arreola's prose. The prose in poetry, as we have seen, and Carmen de Mora gave that explanation. In other texts that he calls Of Memory and Forgetfulness, is a short text, is not the book called Memory and Forgetfulness, but a briefer text that starts with Of Memory and Forgetfulness. He mentions his admiration for the prophet Isaiah, one that manifested the spirit, he says. And we need to discern, to use discernment here, because Isaiah manifested the spirit of God. In the next one that he mentions, he just manifested the clever intelligence of humans. Let me tell you what Arreola wrote. He says, let me drink some water here. Cheers with you. Thank you for your patience, bearing with me with this that I really love. So wait a second. Arreola said in writing, I haven't had the time to wield literature, not I have dedicated every possible hour to love it. Above all things, I love language, and I revere all those whom through the word manifest the spirit. I revere all those whom through the word manifest the spirit. From Isaiah, that's the one that received the spirit of God and was fully manifested in him, to Franz Kafka. So Kafka manifested just the clever spirit of man. That's the difference. One manifested the spirit of God, Isaiah. The other the best with his intelligence of the spirit of man, Kafka. I do not trust the contemporaneous literature, Arreola used to say, and to tell to us as well. I live surrounded by classic shades. Arreola liked it, like the light of the classic writers. In other of his texts, that is called From dell'Osservatore, and you know that l'Osservatore is a newspaper of Rome in Italy. And he points out that Rome lost the keys of the kingdom from the Vatican. I mean, a smaller place, independent, but very near to Rome. That's why it's generically called Rome. So, in this brief text of Arreola, dell'Osservatore, he points out that Rome lost the keys. Rome lost the keys of the kingdom from the beginning of its dominion. And I should have removed the in Spanish, so to make it just from l'Osservatore. So let me read you what it says. From l'Osservatore. At the beginning of our age, the keys of Saint Peter got lost in the suburbs of the Roman Empire. We beseech the person who finds them to have the goodwill to return them immediately to the reigning Pope. As for more than 15 centuries, the doors of the Kingdom of Heaven have not been able to be forced with pick locks. You see, it's very critical, very sarcastic of the lies of Rome. And this is one of his briefest evidences. So we are reaching the next point, that is to vocalize. And Arreola liked to read a lot. So he did vocalize and did an anthology with the things that he vocalized for others. So in 1 Corinthians 13, is one of the scriptures that he put in his own anthology of the best writers of all time for him. And he put it reading in loud voice, in Spanish, lectura en voz alta, from Porrúa, the editorial. And 1 Corinthians 13 says, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not God's love, I am become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy, and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, so that I could remove mountains, and have not God's love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not love, not God's love, it profited me nothing. God's love suffered long, and is kind. God's love envied not. God's love vaunted not itself, is not puffed up, doth not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, or his own, or its own selfishly, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth, beareth all things, believeth all things, hopes all things, endureth all things. God's love never faileth, but whether there be prophecies, whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. As my reading at this point, or when I was reading about prophecies, whether there be tongues, garakati, katifadni, shodniwi, they shall cease. When I am transformed, I won't need them, but I need them now. I love you very much. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. And the context is partial knowledge, as we see in the next verse. Whether there be partial knowledge, it shall vanish away. The full knowledge is going to stay, remain. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spake as a child, I understood as a child, I talked as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass, darkly. They had metal to look at themselves. So we see through a metal, darkly, a mirror metal, but then face to face with Christ and then with his Father, our Father, with God. Then face to face, now I know in part, but then I shall know even as I also am known. And now abideth faith, hope, and God's love, which in Greek is agape, the spiritual love, God's love, God's love. These three, but the greatest of these is God's love. It's one of the beautiful loud voice writings that Arreola recommended us to do frequently, to be in the tune of love. A part of the song of God's love, love that we saw before, that we already read in 1 Corinthians 13, Arreola presented to read out loud from Luke 12 his text against greed. And this is the text of Luke. Let's read it as well. Luke 12, and he spake a parable unto them, this is Jesus, saying, the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do? Because I have no room where to bestow my fruits. And he said, this will I do. I will put down my barns and build greater. And there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said unto him, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? So is he that layeth up treasures for himself, and is not rich towards God. And he said unto his disciples, Jesus to his disciples, therefore I say unto you, take not thought for thy life, take not thought for your life, what ye shall eat, neither for the body, what ye shall put on. The life is more than meat, and the body is more than raiment. Consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap, which neither have storehouse nor barn, and God feedeth them. How much more are ye better than the fowls? and which of you with thought can add with taking, which of you with taking, sorry, with taking thought can add to his stature one cubit? No. If ye then be not able to do that thing which is least, why take ye thought for the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They toil not, they spin not, and yet I say unto you, that Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. If then God so clothed the grass, which is today in the field and tomorrow is cast into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, O ye of little faith? And seek not ye what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, in the sense of being preoccupied, oh, while I should eat or drink today. Cheers. And love for Mary Chris. Mary Chris, I love you. What ye shall drink, neither be ye of doubtful mind, for all these things do the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knoweth that ye have need of these things. But rather, seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. That's another beautiful text that Arreola told us. Read it frequently so that you will know not to be worried about material things. I am not worried at all, he said. And he also chose in his book of the anthology, reading out loud, the benedictions that he found in Saint Matthew. So let me put them in English for you. And they say in Matthew 5, and seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. It means the ones that are meek to receive, the poor in spirit. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. So this is another text that Arreola loved, and we know that it's talking, when we study, it's talking about the age of the future, like the endurance of revelation, and to the overcomers, the entrance into the kingdom of Christ, the millennium, the 1,000 years of the kingdom of Christ, where all of those characteristics are gonna be visible, the characteristics presented there. And then also Arreola used to read to us the strong woman in Proverbs 31. I want to dedicate this to Mary Christ Villa Beto Rubia, my girl, my woman, from Lapu Lapu, Philippines. Proverbs 31. Who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies. The heart of her husband doth safely trust in her. so that he shall have no need of spoil. She will do him good and not evil. And the days, all the days of her life. Let me read it better. She will do him good and not evil all the days of her life. She seeketh wool and flax and worketh willingly with her hands. She is like the merchant's ships. The merchant's ships. She bringeth her food from afar. She riseth also while it is yet night, and giveth meat to her household, and a portion to her maidens. She considereth a field, and buyeth it. With the fruit of her hands she planted a vineyard. She girded her loins with strength, and strengthened her arms. She perceived that her merchandise is good. Her candle goeth not out by night. She layeth her hands to the spindle, and her hands hold the distaff. She sketcheth out her hand to the poor. Yea, she reacheth forth her hands to the needy. She is not afraid of the snow for her household, for all her household are clothed with scarlet. With double clothes, that's the meaning. She maketh herself coverings of... tapestry. Her clothing is silk and purple, the best of the best is the meaning. Her husband is known in the gates, is a respectful man because of her help. Her husband is known in the gates when he sitteth among the elders of the land. She maketh fine linen and selleth it, and delivereth girdles unto the merchant. Strength and honor are her clothing, and she shall rejoice in time to come. She openeth her mouth with wisdom, and in her tongue is the law of kindness. She looketh well to the ways of her household, husband and children, and servants as well, and eateth not the bread of idleness. Not in vain she is working hard. She looketh well to the ways of her household, and eateth not the bread of idleness. Her children arise up and call her blessed. Blessed is my mother. What a beautiful saying of the children. Her husband also, and he praiseth her. You are worthy of everything because you are a hard worker, and I love you more every day. That's an example of the praises that I may say to my woman, Mary Chris. Her children arise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praiseth her. Many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all. Favor is deceitful, and beauty is vain. And you remember the only one that is called strong woman, which is the translation of virtues here, that is, should be better if we say strong. Who can find a strong woman? That's better from the Hebrew. So the only one that is called strong woman is Ruth, the ancestor of Jesus, the ancestor of David. So maybe this is praising Ruth, and is reflected to every good and strong woman on Israel first, and then on the rest of Christianity, of us. So, many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all. Favor is deceitful, and beauty is vain. But a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised. And this is Yahweh, the faithful God, the God that will be what you will need him to be for you. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. So she is also praised in the same gates where her husband rules. Select. But Arreola also selected writings from others, such as one by Fray Luis de Granada, to the knowledge of God, related this writing to the knowledge of God through the creatures. Let's read it. Knowledge of God through the creatures. We are like children that when they receive a book in front of them with some shining and golden letters, they stare at them and start playing with them without reading what they are saying. Those books, what those books say, the little children cannot read them, nor considering what they signify. So do us, even more childish than children, we behave. Having you, Lord, put in front of us this so wondrous book of the whole universe, the creation of God, the stars, the animals, the sea, that through its creatures, as with living letters, we could be able to read and to know the excellence of the creator, the excellence of the creator that such things did, and the love that he has for us. He who did them for us, and us as children could do nothing but to delight ourselves on looking the so beautiful things, without wanting to notice what is it that the Lord wants to signify through them. So we don't perceive fully, is what Luis de Granada is saying. To all of us, Lord, befalls on us when we devote ourselves to consider the wonders of this work, your work, like a rustic villager, ourselves being like the rustic villager, the gardener, the worker of the fields, that entering again into some big city or into some royal house with numerous and diverse lodgings and soaked up of looking the beauty of the building, he forgets the door from which he entered, and he comes to get lost in the midst of the house, and he doesn't know where to go, neither where to go back, if there is none to tell him and to guide him. So the Hotel California of the Eagles is like this lost peasant that don't know how to go out until somebody that is good will tell him the way to go out. It says here, because what are, Lord, all the cities and all the royal palaces but nests for swallow birds? If we compare them with this royal house that you did create, because if in that such a very small hole a creature with reason gets lost, what will it do in such a variety and grandeur of things of your whole creation? How will it swim in such a great depth of wonders, one that drowns in such a small rivulet? So guide me, you, Lord, in this journey. Guide this rustic villager by the hand and show to him with the finger of your spirit the wonders and mysteries of your works, that through them I could be able to adore you, to be reborn in your wisdom, your omnipotence, your beauty, your providence, so that in such a way I could be able to bless and to praise and to glorify you through the ages of ages. So he say basically, I need to be born again to understand the greatness of your creation. And the only way we know to do that is by receiving the fullness of Holy Spirit. So in this aspect of selecting, in his inventory of Arreola, we found one poem by Manuel Gutiérrez Nájera, a great poet of Mexico, entitled The Good God and the Bad God, in which certainly the good one wins. And this is my translation of that. The Good God and the Bad God, the final fragment, by Manuel Gutiérrez Nájera. When entombed under the ground, those lights ablaze he saw, to God the devil said, I have also my heaven. You'll see if the loving and innocent maidens do not prefer my diamonds to your pale stars. At last, safe in my prison, in power you'll not equal me. I will make weapons of iron, and with lead I'll make bullets, is the devil still speaks. So, after the devil ended his speaking, the good God, immortal, took the rough lead. He lifts, and of that humble metal, he did the letters for printing. So God said, okay, you are using metal to produce weapons, I will use metal for the printer, for the press, the good press, to print the first book ever printed was the Bible by Gutenberg. The bad God, blind with rage, defeated already by the good, fell as by a ray wounded in a boiling sea of fire. So, this is the end of the poem, The Good God and the Bad God. And then Arreola says, I did learn by memory and I recited when I was a kid this poem of The Good God and the Bad God. And I did receive many claps. I believe that all of you agree with me. I am going to win at the deepest, even if I apparently am losing. At the end, in the depth of my thoughts, I will win, he says. Even if I have so much material things, not so much money, if I have the spiritual things here inside, I am the winner. I keep myself afloat, Arreola wrote, attached to this last saving table. Fundamentally, I believe with Manuel Gutierrez Nájera in the good God. That's how Arreola ends his writing. Then Arreola also selected from whom? Let me see here. I went out. Arreola also selected from Saint Gertrude a writing in which she mentions that the droplet or the spark can not exist separated from their source. So let me see what I am doing wrong here. Oh, here, yes. I was jumping. So, Quiet Light of the Soul by Saint Gertrude, a female. That's another selection of Arreola. Quiet light of the soul, O shining morning in the sweetest of hearts. Transform yourself in my day. Love that not only shines, you are a deifying love. And I ask you to come to me with all your power and dissolve me in such tenderness. Destroy what I am and let me proceed towards you, all myself complete, in such a way that I could stop by being subject to time, but tightly joined to you for all eternity. I want to stop being just subject to transitory things and time, and to be bound with you very tightly for all eternity, is what she is writing. You were the first one who loved me. You did choose me. Oh, that's beautiful. And it has been you who approached the creature, and you approached to me, your forehead and an eternal blaze. You approached to me, your forehead and eternal blaze. Show me your face shining due to the divine sun. How would the spark itself survive, detached from the fire that produces it? And how could the droplet of water continue its existence out of the source from which it has sprung? Love, why did you love me? I am stained. I am a stained creature, and only in you will I be able to recover my beauty. Love, O precious noontide, if I could rest in you a thousand times, will I beseech my rest. Love, O beloved light, I want the blazing and sacred fire. Let me read the end again, because the letters are smaller. So cheers again with water. If I could rest in you, 1,000 times will I beseech my rest. Love, O beloved night, I want the blazing and sacred fire of your divine essence to consume in a moment the mistakes of my life. O sweet night of mine, let me sleep in you like a quiet dream. Let me enjoy the bliss of rest that you prepare for all the ones that you love. Through the way of your serene look and field of delight, you order, set out and prepare my eternal wedding. Love, be for me this night so precious, as much as that my soul could say goodbye to its body transported by joy, and that my spirit could be able to go back to the Lord that gave it to me, so that I could peacefully rest under your so precious shadow. And of course, she's coming from the Platonic tradition, which is the one that the Catholics adopted. But I need to correct this point in the sense that we are going to be resurrected also to have a body of flesh and bone. Because if God created the body, He's going to make it perfect and immortal when we receive our immortal body. So it's not that the body is disposable, as the Platonic people and the Catholic people thinks, is that God is going to make a better body, but it's going to be a physical body that is going to be under the control of our spiritual body, like Jesus Christ. When He was resurrected, He was able to decide when to make Himself visible and how to make Himself visible, and when to disappear, when to cross through the walls, went to travel very fast from one place to another. So it's going to be awesome that time. And noticeably, with the help of his sister Virginia, the sister of Arreola that wrote the preface, the prologue for my book, Arreola selected every fragment of human neediness in the epistles of Góngora, another big writer of the century of gold of Spanish literature. And here we're gonna see the earthly meals, a fragment that I also translated for you. With 500 reales, royals is like say $500, Spain's money at that time, from here to the end of December, and an ant with $500 from here to the end of December, an ant cannot pass. How about one that has honor? And that we could be able to fix this, my poor meals, in order that I can be able to eat even if I never dine. I beg your grace to put a remedy in all of that, as I am not even able to remember myself or my meals. There is a lack of light, there is not even twilight of comfort. Night is what I am living, and the worst part is without having anything to dine in it. So all of these are very kind of funny fragments of the real writings of Góngora, the poet of the golden century of the Spanish writing. And I am at the winter's threshold with not a thread for clothes, he says. Mr. Luis de Góngora y Argote Epistolari. So Arreola, with the help of his sister, selected all of these fragments that are funny, and he called them the earthly meals, and just with that he did a publication. The next point is remember. And he, when going to sleep, Arreola did remember poems by Pellicer, and we're gonna see some of those fragments that are beautiful by Pellicer, that is looking at heaven, and then is with Arreola at the center top, dedicated to God. Lord, I am on the threshold of the jungle. Flowers of the road are those you see. I lead them on the altar of your greatness. Now, Lord, forgive me and leave a flower with me. Whichever you want. There was a rush of notes by violins amidst of the victorious shout of the sounding. clarinets, of the sounding clarinets. And the Lord asked, say, to whom it is, to whom it is that you want the one flower that you want to keep from me? Lord, it is for a woman. Oh, that is beautiful. It is for Mary Chris, I will say. It is for a woman. Song of the Perfect Love, a fragment, some fragments, also written by Pellicer in 1914. Let's see, the other one, I forgot to put the date, but this Song of the Perfect Love is from 1914, and it says in the next way, today I do not ask, Lord, today I do not ask you for anything. My love is already perfect, only sweetness and praise over the docile wave of my heart. I bring to you a garland of roses, silver and black. Very nice. He talks of black roses as Fray Luis de León. A lyre that itself sings to you. Its arms are of oak and its strings are of palm. Its strings, the strings of the harp, or the lyre, is another instrument like the harp, are of palm. Today I do not ask you for anything. I bring to you a garland of black and silver roses. Nothing I ask you today, I only fill you with praises. Sweetness and praise, let perfect be love. Oh, that's another beautiful poem. Let perfect be love. It says, I don't want to ask you nothing. I have everything. Now the only thing I want to do is to praise you, to worship you, to be thankful with you. That's a beautiful. That's the heart of the real Christian living today. Another that Arreola did remember frequently was the French Paul Claudel, who had a beautiful sister, Camille Claudel. And from the group of the Apostles, I selected some fragments written by Claudel and that Arreola translated into Spanish about the Apostle James, the half-brother of Jesus. It says, all the apostles are gone. They did run out of Jerusalem when it was about to be destroyed by the Romans. All the apostles are gone, but James, the brother of Christ, remains. Alone in the Jerusalem that the real Israelite has deserted, that city since now perfect and filled in which is gathered a whole people over which the blood did fall and which awaits their ruin. Because the Romans flattened. They didn't even leave stone over stone of the temple of Jerusalem. So what is the wailing wall today that the Jews pray is not part of the temple of Jerusalem. It's part of the Roman fortress Antonia. So they are praying to an idol, thinking that it's a fragment of their temple, but it is not. Remember the words of Jesus, the words truthful of Jesus said, not even a stone over a stone will be left, not of the temple, neither of the city of Jerusalem. So that's why it says here, the blood did fall and which awaits their ruin. The blasphemed temple still has 40 years remaining from the day of James to when in 70 AD were totally destroyed by the Romans. About Paul, this is what Paul Claudel, his namesake, wrote. Paul the Apostle is being written to by Paul Claudel, the poet. I beg you, they could hear like me before the hour and the process had concluded. That voice that tells to them, Paul, I am the Jesus that you have persecuted. That's very interesting. So he's remembering at this point Arreola, the writing of Claudel, where Claudel himself remembers Paul listening to Jesus in the way to Damascus in the vision, and Jesus says to Paul, Paul, I am the Jesus that you have persecuted. About John, this is what is written. John that saw the end of things and that was at bay between the seas and the heaven, while the seventh veil was being torn. John has no more but only one word for all of us. My children, this is beautiful, my children love one another. Something that we very easily forget. Then we have the points of imitate, to imitate. And in the aspect of imitating, Arreola used to say with confidence that he was inspired in Giovanni Papini for some of his desolation writings. So these are the fragments of the Arreola novel, The Fair, that had the description of the desolation that he took inspired by the writings of Giovanni Papini. This is the Italian that I was trying to remember earlier, the French Claudel and the Italian Papini. Arreola writes in his novel of The Fair, another letter and another envelope were waiting for me. The thick handwriting of Matilde said, I went to Tamazula. Arreola's wife was from this place. With my peoples, when you are free from accompanying blue stocking girls, come to get me. The package contained the two flasks of cream of jute. This blue stocking girl was selling cream of jute and a book of her writings. And Arreola, as the writer of the social club of writing, was accompanying her to sell all of these things house to house in the town. And he bought some for his real wife, but the wife left the package. The package contained the two flasks of cream of jute, one full and the other already started. I have slept alone after so many years. I haven't slept alone after so many years. I should have translated this, sorry, but now I remember by memory the Spanish. In the immensely empty house, I really felt my loneliness. I will keep the Alexandrite as a precious memory. She received an Alexandrite stone from this blue stocking girl. I will keep the Alexandrite as a precious memory. But tomorrow indeed, I'll go to Tamazula to pick up Matilde. So he stayed one night alone and he felt very, very lonely. And the other passage writing of loneliness in The Fair is this one. With pain that she, actually fragments of Arreola's diary from 07-09-1941, referring to his future wife, then his attempted girlfriend, denied her departure, as I was aware through a friend of her. So his girlfriend said that she will not leave when she actually left the town. I returned from her house very happy, thinking of a long happiness, before he realized that she is gone, that she was gone. On Monday, I was in a store buying the gift for her upcoming birthday, without knowing that she had already left on Sunday. What a big pain to find the house empty. And the rain, what a sad role was it playing at those moments. I was letting myself to get wet, refusing to accept the reality. So this is another passage of loneliness that if you read it again by yourself, you can read it even better than the way I did it right now. So sorry about that. And of one of his more relaxed works, with a comedy bias, he said to be inspired by the funny French writer Georges Duhamel, another of the favorites of Arreola, not so well known. It's hard to find his writings even in Spanish today, but he was very inspiring to Arreola. And it says, Arreola, based on that writer, I read with particular interest the books that Virginia, a widow willing to marry the narrator, provides for me. She has a small library but she selects with taste. I just read a book, Reflections of the Christian Gentleman, which the editor Carmen de Mora considers, this is my note, as being the classic Enchiridion by Erasmus of Rotterdam, in Spanish, translated by Damaso Alonso. Then we continue then the writing of Arreola, especially if the single man has at his motto, has as his motto such a book. I almost dare to assert that for a celibate man, results impossible to carry a virtuous life. However, some attempts may be done. As my marriage with Virginia is not so far away, my note is some 6 months that marriage never happened because his secretary ended up being pregnant by somebody else, a rich, corrupt, bigoted man. The narrator decides to protect her name by marrying her. So the narration continues, written by Arreola. I try to keep myself under certain disciplines, with the end to reach that state under a relative state of purity. That state is the state of marriage under a relative state of purity. I have always felt a great void within my heart. It is true that Virginia fills my existence, but there, in a particular site, that void subsists. Virginia is not a person to whom I could give a protection. Rather, I must say that she protects me, a poor, lonely man. Regularly, I do charitable gifts, he said, the narrator, charitable gifts. But I wish to do a specific good and perfectly well-directed, a good well-directed, to help somebody in a constant, efficacious way, in the way done to a person that is dear to us, to a relative, maybe to a son, so well that protective instinct remains and claims within the most profound places of my being. I cherish the illusion of having a son who could be able to receive that unemployed tenderness, who responds to my call paternal and deep. When we were leaving, I discovered at the base of the monument this beautiful inscription: he did good while he lived. He did good while he lived. Which I decide to take as motto. The quoted phrase gives the title to Arreola's short story and refers to the burial monument of the first husband of Virginia. This is my note. Later on, the narrator discovers that such a man left 3 sons out of wedlock that are living in the most extreme misery and depravity, discovering as well that the prudery of Virginia knows about them but completely ignores them, even under the awareness of them by almost everybody else in town. He did good while he lived is a nice, sarcastic as well novel written by Juan José Arreola, inspired by the French Georges Duhamel. And once again, it is emphasized that Arreola was inspired by the scriptures of the Bible. Juan José Arreola said, "The Bible of the BAC, the Library of Christian Authors in Spanish, Biblioteca de Autores Cristianos, edited in 3 volumes, is the only complete Bible already removed by the Church, the Catholic Church." And I just need to remember when I read Saint Gertrude in her writing, I just need to say that when she says, "I am going to wedding my own," referring to the Lord Jesus, we as members of the body of Christ are members of the actual body of Christ. So the one that is going to be the wife, the one that is going to be married to Christ and to his body, which is us, is the Jewish nation, the Israelites, the real Israelites that at the end believe are going to be the wife, the girlfriend, and we're going to be the husband, because we are part of the body of Christ, just to clarify that. But the Catholic Church removed this version of the Bible, and was by Bober and Cantera, which are the best translators. They dared, Arreola says, to say those things that no one else did. Here Arreola quotes the passage into question by memory. The way Arreola remembers that passage of this Bible, Bober Cantera, in Spanish, he remembered it in the next way. "You put your stall of sin at the crossroad of the road, and you opened your legs to the first one that was passing." But the actual excerpt from the Bober and Cantera translation of the Bible of Ezekiel 16:25 by José María Bober and Francisco Cantera Burgos says, and in every head of the way you built a brothel, and you dishonored your beauty, and you opened your legs to every passerby, and multiplied your harlotry. And a note from Bober and Cantera, found in the original, head of the way is or crossing corner or bend of streets and roads. My note, the translator's note, says this passage was important in Arreola's writings, such as in the long blended confession of people from Zapotlan after the earthquake, in his soul novel The Fair, and elsewhere he used this passage several times. And this is another one, this is for adults, so children just pass this fragment by. But he was also inspired by works that seemed to have been originated in a surrealistic world, such as a very rare one related to medicine. So for many years, from 1971 to 1995, people used to believe that this was an invention of Arreola, until somebody remembered in 1995 and put it into writing, that somebody told him that this was an actual thesis, research, publication. And the narrative starts with Arreola's statement that, falling from the sky without me seeking for it or requesting it, comes to fall into my hands the Himen in Mexico, el Himen en México in Spanish. And this is also the title of the short story or text by Arreola, the same as the thesis, the same as the title of the 1885 thesis, noticeable work by Mr. Francisco A. Flores, Dr. Flores, printed without erratum in the typographic office of the Secretariat of Development, all of this originally in Spanish, actual institutions. Then Arreola continues by quoting the original. The subject matter of which this work is concerned is, and by far, of those that seduce me, it seems that in my moments of solace, I cherish the idea of dedicating part of my future for study, and should be for its study. And this is a reliable transcription of the actual thesis of this material, in which Arreola gets inspired to write a very funny text portion used by Arreola. Inspire! Then we are already in Inspire. And let's read what it says here. To speak about the inspiration, Arreola did use the term numen and the numinous, and he said that it was originated in a source external to him. His favorite text related to this was from Rudolf Otto. He's a man that is described there in his writing. The saint, the rational, and the irrational, but I should translate it, and the supra-rational, in the idea of God, in the concept of God, which is, of course, the real God. Rudolf Otto, 1869-1937. The whole is the rational with L at the end, and the irrational in the idea of God. Then we are going to leave. And about living, Arreola used to tell us that Francisco de Aldana and others lived intensely both the spiritual and the human experience. So let's read this, what Francisco de Aldana wrote. But a sonnet 18, again, is for adults, so children pass this fragment. And then a fragment of the letter to Arias Montano, which is good for everybody. So by Francisco de Aldana. What is the cause, my Damon, that being in the fight of love together, locked with tongues, arms, feet, and chained, like vine that the jasmine gets is entangling? And chained like vine that the jasmine gets entangling? And that the vital breath but taking in our lips, tired of sucking in the midst, to so much good are we forced to mourn and sigh from time to time? That's the question of her, and his answer is love, my beautiful Phyllis, that in there our souls were joined, desiring in its forge as well to join the bodies, deciding in its force, maybe, the force of love, as well to join the bodies, so strong that not being able to join the bodies, like a sponge to water, to pass from the soul to the sweet beloved center, Christ, the mortal veil, his niggard fortune. It basically, this is saying, in the same way that the souls get as one in marriage when you are with your couple, my Chris, that we wish also to get as one in our bodies and remain as one forever, is what this sonnet is saying. But as we cannot keep the bodies remaining as one constantly, 24/7, all time, we need to at least keep our souls together. And because we cannot keep our bodies as one all time, we mourn and we sigh and we say, oh my God, when are we gonna be together as one forever? Then the fragment of the letter to Arias Montano. I think on departing from the common race that the cliffs follow and to walk straight, labor of my real nation, to enter in the secret of my chest and to speak in it my inner man, of his going, staying, if he's alive or what he has been of him, of what has been of him, and cause vain error won't surprise me more. And cause vain error won't surprise me more in some high and solitary nest. I think on burying my being, my life and name, and if I hadn't been born here, to stay there, like echo reposting to the sweet croon of God. So he wants to be also as one with God. It's very interesting because that is possible and real. When you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord, you receive the Spirit Holy of God, the Holy Spirit of God, and you became one with God. So one talks about unity between man and woman, very interesting, very beautiful, and the other talks about unity of man with God. Right is one of the next ones, and here I want to put also an example of one of my own poems that I put in my second book. My first book, Arreola's Class, I will send it a little later to the editors, and together a book of poems that will include this one and my poems of my early age, my adolescent, and some of my childhood. So inspired by his best poetical findings, such as that of Malherbe, related to the fruit is the fulfillment of the promise of the flower. Look, what a beautiful statement. Is the best line of the whole poetry of France. The fruit is the fulfillment of the promise of the flower. I wrote my own tent, my free tent, because it's 10 lines, which is entitled The Promise. So another thing that I'm gonna read to Marie Chris, The Promise by Fernando Castro, by me. Such as the fruit is the fulfillment of the promise of the bottom and its flower, the butterfly is the fulfillment of the promise of the worm and its cocoon. The chicken is the fulfillment of the promise of the hen and of its egg. And the baby is the fulfillment of the promise of the woman and her belly. The eternity, in the same way, is the fulfillment. The eternity is the fulfillment of the human promise and they're anointed. That was my free poem, and in Spanish you can read it here. It's very small, but it can be seen. And then we have Teach, and we are close to the end. Teach is near the end, is the last one. Once you have lived, once you have written, you teach. And it says here, Juan José Arreola was a professor of a whole generation of writers. See above some of the writers that are included here, and I include my photo here. This is the other writer, wannabe writer, that is also myself, inspired by Arreola as a professor. I am here. Yeah. Okay. Rulfo, Juan Rulfo Borges, Jorge Luis Borges, that is presented here when he was young, who was better looking than when he got older. So we have the picture of Rulfo, then Borges, Fuentes, Carlos Fuentes, a traitor that committed treason against Arreola and blamed him. Fuentes blamed Arreola of being communist when Arreola was not at all communist. So Fuentes was like kind of a coward. Agustin is another great writer, Jose Agustin, that was also a student of Arreola, like myself. Poniatowska was a student of Arreola, and even the mother of one of the children of Arreola, of a male, Arreola Poniatowska, Poniatowsko, but she didn't recognize him as father. Leñero is another great writer that was a student of Arreola. Campbell, Aura, Avilés, Fabila, Nava, Amor, Beirabi, Samperio, De La Torre, Garro, Renan, García Ponce, this is another Renan, García Ponce, Valadez, Ojeda, Preciado. This is Vicentito, Vicente Preciado, who was a big help and inspiration also for me to write my own book, because he also took notes of the classes that he received from Arreola. Orso Arreola, the son of Arreola, was also inspired by his father, Juan José Arreola. And I even forgot Virginia. Virginia Arreola was inspired by her brother. And Bracho, that was also an actor. And as we have seen, Arreola himself was a disciple of many other writers, a part of the Bible, and of the ones already mentioned. He was also a disciple of Ortega y Gasset, that we have no time to mention, fragments of their writings, of Kafka, of Rilke, had a beautiful writing about the histories of the good God, Rilke. And these are the three ones that are first portrayed here: Ortega y Gasset at the left, Kafka next, then Rilke, then Melville, the same one that wrote Moby Dick. The same Melville wrote a short story that Arreola really liked very, very much, and say that was one of the best ever. Bartleby, written by Melville. Andreyev is also portrayed here, one of the short story from Russia. William Faulkner is also here, and not portrayed is Schwab, Montaigne, Lopez Velarde, Proust, Neruda, Gomez de la Serna, Ivanov, y Gershenson. About education, they were inspiring to Arreola, so all of them were persons that Arreola liked to read a lot. And here, apart of portraying Poniatowska here, the one in glasses below from the previous slide is the next one after Poniatowska is Leñero, and the one at her left is Agustín. Just for you to know, you can find the rest. And this is one of the last ones, I think is the last one. So about teaching, my dream is, I just completed my teaching of GED. What is GED in the United States? Is a general education degree. It's the equivalent to high school. And in United States, you can do it in few months. And if you pass 4 tests, you get your high school diploma to go to college or to get a better salary. So I was teaching. The last time I was in the United States, after the floodings in Houston, I was teaching GED classes to 20 students that just completed their tests in 2 months. Half of them completed most of their tests, if not all. And the 4 topics that they need to approve is mathematics, is language arts, is social sciences, and is sciences, which is all the biology, the chemistry, the physics. So if you pass all of them, you made it. And these are some of the important persons that have taken their GED to go ahead with their lives. You can see their sports ladies, and you can see also male actors that are important, are famous, and they took their GED. And finally, so concluding, and this is one of the signatures that Arreola gave me behind his photograph of he walking in bike, as he liked to say. Concluding, the 12 points of Arreola's class are read, originals, compare, discern, vocalize, select, remember, imitate, inspire, live, write, and teach. So thank you very much. I am so thankful with, as we say in Texas, with y'all. I am so thankful with you all for all of this, your patience. So I am just to say thank you for the opportunity you gave me, God, to present this to the people that I love, and hopefully my book does good talking about these topics and the other about poetry. So I love you. I love you, Mary Chris, and everybody that is watching this. And I say goodbye. God bless you with all my heart. So let me reduce it a little to escape from here and to stop my presentation. Bye-bye.